So my name is Katherine Ellena. I'm a senior legal specialist at IFAS, focused on legal frameworks for elections, election dispute resolution, and electoral integrity. I've had the pleasure of visiting and working in many IFAS programs in the world. I actually just came back from Kenya last night, so I take comfort that some of us may all be suffering from jet lag. But I'm very happy to see so many colleagues from around the world here in DC on the eve of a very historic election. It's historic for me too. At 6 o'clock tomorrow morning, I will be casting a ballot for the first time as an American. So these elections are very different from my home country, New Zealand. So my three panelists are here to address the thorny issue of money in politics. This has already come up in both of the panels this morning, so I know there's going to be a lot of questions. I'm very happy to have three different perspectives for you on the panel today. Focused on campaign finance regulation, civil society oversight of campaign finance, and then campaign fundraising and strategy. So I would like to welcome Anne Ravel, the commissioner with the Federal Election Commission. Appointed to the commission in 2013 and served as chair in 2015. Prior to this, Anne was chair of the California Fair Political Practices Commission. So she oversaw the regulation of campaign finance, lobbying, ethics, and conflicts of interest. Very easy job. She was instrumental in creating a web-based center for sharing information on campaign finance. And in 2014, she was named California Attorney of the Year by California Lawyer magazine for her work in government law. And then I have Sheila Krumholz, who's the Executive Director for the Center for Responsive Politics. So as Executive Director, Sheila is liaison to the board and major funders and the primary spokesperson, and is obviously very busy at this time in the electoral cycle. So she first joined the organization in 1989 as an assistant editor of Open Secrets. And I encourage you to visit that website, opensecrets.org, with a lot of information about campaign finance. And in 2010, Fast Company magazine named Sheila to its most influential women in politics, in technology list. And then Jess Yescalis. He's the president of Yescalis Campaign Strategies. Jess has worked on hundreds of political campaigns. He's personally raised over $105 million for political campaigns, public policy organizations, and independent expenditure committees, which we'll talk a little bit more about. In this election, Jess served as the Arizona Finance co-chair for the Marco Rubio campaign. And he's served in various roles in the Republican Party in Arizona, Hawaii, and at the national level. Jess is also very active internationally. We first met actually in Fiji in a program advising new members of parliament and moderating town halls across the country. I think we have some colleagues from Fiji here today. So Jess, on a personal note, has visited 131 countries and is over halfway to his goal of doing something meaningful or fun in every country in the world. So he's worth following on Facebook. So, as with many things in life, money is needed to run an election campaign. Campaign material, advertising messages, opinion polls, campaign staff, travel, all cost. Without money, candidates struggle to reach voters, to persuade them how to vote. Although I think we've seen in this election that free platforms such as Twitter do make it easier. Spending on campaigns can therefore be a positive good in the sense that it can inform the electorate about individuals, parties, and policies. But some groups, some individuals, have a lot more money than others. And arguably, money can influence the outcome of a contest or the governance decisions that are being made after someone is elected. So because money is both necessary for elections, but also potentially harmful to elections. We require rules and processes to govern how it can and cannot be used. Surprisingly to me, New Zealand, my home country, the rules there are significantly weaker than they are in the US. We allow foreign donations, anonymous donations, donations from corporations and labor unions, and we have weak enforcement of spending limits. However, in that country, we have a low-cost environment, it's generally not corrupt, and there's an absence of any sort of galvanizing scandal that has forced us to change. I don't know if that will last. In the US, and Commissioner Ravel will talk more about this, foreign corporate labor union donations are prohibited, but there is a high-cost campaign environment and significant spending by private individuals in sort of parallel campaigns, which do not exist in New Zealand and I think many of your countries. So a quick snapshot, and I know Sheila will touch on this further. 2016 elections, up to $6.9 billion they will cost, which is a significant percent of GDP for some countries. To put it in perspective for you though, in America we will spend $8 billion on Halloween. And apparently this increases during an election year, I think because people need relief from the 3.3 million advertisements they are bombarded with. There are over 40 fundraising bodies associated with the presidential candidates. Some are super PACs. You've probably heard the term political action committees. They can raise unlimited money from individuals, corporations, and labor unions, but they must disclose the donors. They cannot contribute directly to a campaign or coordinate with a candidate, but they can spend as much as they like in parallel. In addition, we have organizations in the US known as 501c4s, tax-exempt sort of social welfare groups who also spend to influence elections. These do not have to disclose donors. Obviously, behind these groups are wealthy donors with big stakes. The super PACs this year have raised $1 billion, a record, although evenly split generally between Republican and Democrat. Over half of that amount, around, has been contributed by about 90 individual billionaires. So hence, advocates for limits on political donations say a small number of wealthy donors are drowning out the common folk and should be limited. Contributors say they are exercising their free speech rights. So where does the truth lie? The Supreme Court looked at this question in the case Citizens United and ruled that political speech is at the core of the First Amendment to the Constitution, that this right of political free speech is fundamental and should not be restricted, even with corporations. So views on this decision are strongly divided, potentially on this panel as well. A Bloomberg poll in 2015 found that 78% of respondents said this ruling was a bad decision. Others have argued that by removing limits on political speech, it weakened government control of who can speak, how much, and on what subject, which is a good thing. So this panel is not just about Citizens United in this decision, but what we're primarily looking to talk about today is influence. Who has it? To what degree? Can influence be controlled? And how much, if at all, does money influence the outcome of an election or governance decisions by people in power after an election? So with some of these very big questions in mind, I will turn over to our first panelist, Commissioner Ravel.
Thank you very much, Katherine. And what you didn't mention about Halloween spending is that maybe a third of that $8 billion is actually spent on outfits for dogs. So that kind of puts money into perspective in the United States. But thank you very much for the kind introduction, and I'm so glad to be here and have been invited by IFAS to be with world leaders in this area, which is really important. The topic of money and politics is extremely important in this election that you're here to observe. As most of you can appreciate, even as jet-lagged as you are, this election has been extraordinary, to say the least, in many ways. But extraordinary doesn't describe what I believe is the takeaway from this campaign, and that is, in many ways, but also with regard to campaign finance issues, how vulnerable this country is to the undermining of what are our democratic institutions. And it's clear also that a number of Americans are disaffected from the government and from the political system. We don't know how many people are going to vote tomorrow, but in 2012, the number of people that voted in this country was at the lowest since World War II, 72 years ago, at 36%. And a lot of people say that disaffection and uninterest, lack of interest in voting has to do with their views about the relationship between money and our political system. Obviously, there's lots of other things. There's the economy, there's, you know, many other aspects. But when asked, many people say this. And one of the ideals of, you know, American electoral processes that citizens, all citizens, should have an equal say in the decisions that affect their lives. But the reality is, nobody believes that's true. Recent surveys show that only a third of us think that we have an equal chance to influence electoral outcomes. Two-thirds of Americans think that the wealthy have more of a chance to influence the election than anyone else. And 85% of Americans, and this is Americans of every political view, Republicans, Democrats, independents, say that they think we need to fundamentally change the way we fund political campaigns. In my view, they're right. And Katherine mentioned some of this about the small numbers of people who spend most of the money in the campaigns. Just about a month ago, the Washington Post had an article in which they said just 10 individuals and couples contributed nearly 20% of the $1 billion that was raised by super PACs by the end of the summer. And notably, which I think also has an impact on our country, is that the most prolific donors to super PACs are overwhelmingly white and male, even though the voter eligible population in this country is at its most diverse in our history. So you talked about money and how much money there is. My issue is not with the amount of money, because I really do believe that money facilitates the ability of candidates to get their message out to the voters. So I'm not so troubled by the money per se. What I think is troubling about it is that the vast majority of campaign funds come from a tiny, highly unrepresentative segment of people who then wield disproportionate power. And they certainly, together with corporate interests, have much greater influence on public policy. And I mean, we can save this for the discussion, but a Nobel Prize winning economist found, Joseph Stiglitz did a study and found that federal policy is entirely dominated by the wealthy and by corporate interests, and that individuals and grassroots organizations have absolutely no influence on federal policy in the United States. So that's what I'm concerned about with regard to money. I think you've talked about Citizens United and other court decisions. Citizens United isn't the only one. There's been a long line of decisions. But they have permitted these unlimited contributions by corporations, unions, and individuals if, as you said, they give to an entity that is independent of the candidate, because if it's independent, then there can be no corruption. They also said that these independent contributions will not be corrupting because of the internet and how much disclosure there is. There's so much information about campaigns that it cannot be corrupting. So people will know the source of the contributions and where the money goes. But the reality is something very different. And I think you talked a little bit about this. But let me say that at the agency of which I am a commissioner has actually not done the job that it is supposed to do in order to even uphold those laws that the Supreme Court has clearly said are still in existence and that are important for this election. Because of an ideological view of one block of the commissioners that emulates in some ways the polarization in the country and the polarization in Congress, this block of commissioners can prevent any regulation, any investigation of complaints, or providing of transparency in elections. And they are opposed to campaign finance laws. They therefore disagree with the purpose of the agency. So doing what is so important to the public in one of the most significant elections in my lifetime, for sure, we're not doing the job that Congress intended us to do to ensure the integrity and fairness of elections and to provide full disclosure. In fact, some of the Washington, D.C. campaign finance lawyers have called it the Wild West of campaign finance. Anything goes. And this can be seen when we address, and you spoke about some of these things, that it appears that super PACs are actually closely aligned with and coordinating with candidates, but my agency has failed to even do any regulations about this new law, which isn't that new. It's been in existence for about 7 years, and therefore not enforced the law for any coordination. And the same is true for those 501c4s and other groups that actually are operating as political committees and therefore do not disclose their donors. And there's lots of other ways to circuitously funnel money to not disclose their donors. So what we have, and you said it, it's a parallel campaign finance system where candidates and political parties have to disclose, have to follow the law, and do. And we have a huge amount of information about that on our website that Sheila gets to look at. But in effect, a large amount of the money is totally anonymous, and we have no way of knowing who's behind those campaigns, which the Supreme Court, as I said, has clearly upheld. So I think I'm done with my time, but I will happy to answer questions too.
Great. Thank you, Commissioner. And maybe just before we move on to the next speaker, I might just break with how we've been approaching it and perhaps ask a quick question just in response to your comments. You mentioned the ideological block that you've got within the commission, a real barrier. Obviously, we have a lot of election commissions in the room here. some of whom have only one or just a few commissioners, other that have a large number. And so this can be a real challenge in terms of the differing personalities or perspectives on the commission. How can you sort of break through a block like that? I know you were chair last year. What are some solutions to that kind of challenge?
I think that the problem that we have on the commission at the moment is, I mean, for one thing, it's a six-member commission, and no more than three can be of one political party, and it requires four votes to even investigate a complaint, much less, as I say sometimes, to let me go to the bathroom. So, just kidding. You know, it is very difficult, given the political environment that we are now in, to ever get four votes to either regulate, enforce, do any of the things that we're supposed to do. However, there are, I am the only one that's still in a term. Everybody else is a holdover. One of our members has been a holdover since 2007. And so they're appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. It seems to me that this commission should be end its term when the next president comes in, whoever that is, and that president should set up a commission or a committee of people to actually find individuals of all parties who will follow the law.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. You talked a bit about transparency and how important that is, that it's not so much the concern of how much money is in elections, but just how transparent it is and who has influence stemming from that money. So we'll turn now to my next panelist, Sheila Krumholz, who can talk about the issue of transparency, which has been her focus for a long time. Thank you, Sheila.
Thank you. Thank you, Katherine. Thanks to IFAS and to all of you for your interest. Yes, I'm going to talk about what the research shows in terms of the amount and role of money in the elections. The influence and trends in campaign contributions and lobbying have long been significant and arguably problematic. However, few can remember a presidential election so acrimonious and frankly disturbing as the one we're in now, so much so that money almost comes in a distant second, which is quite unusual. But the enormous sums of money that fuel the campaigns, the sources, how the money is spent and by whom, also plays a role in how electoral battles are waged. So you really can't discuss the one without acknowledging that they're intertwined. I'm happy to report that there is some good news, at least for transparency and for my organization, the Center for Responsive Politics, where things have been hopping. In just the last week or two, we have launched a new mobile-friendly website, so you can check out our opensecrets.org website on your mobile phone or tablet and see a much better site, I hope. We've unveiled our official pre-election projections on spending in 2016. We published a year-long investigation with the legendary Boston Globe Spotlight team about a law firm that paid its partners millions in bonuses in a complicated and, we believe, illegal campaign contribution reimbursement scheme. We launched an important new resource to track undisclosed money, and we revved up our online tools to track political ad buys. So I think the good news is that there's new information, there are new resources coming online at the same time that the systematic problems and specific problems may grow more challenging. And now here we are meeting with you who care deeply about what's happening in these elections and in democracy across the globe. I'm going to give you a short briefing on the latest findings with just a few slides and then offer some general comments about our work. At CRP, we continually access data made available by the Federal Election Commission, some of which we update several times a day. So thank you, Commissioner Ravel, for your agency's absolutely essential work. And every election, we tally how much will be spent And extrapolating from the latest figures, we project that at $6.9 billion, this will be the most expensive election in U.S. history, up from $6.3 billion in 2012. And here we show the split by type of race, congressional in tan versus presidential in green, and by party. So you can see that it is relatively evenly split between the Democratic and Republican parties, with green being third in other money, third party in other money. On what will that money be spent? The biggest driver of the leap in spending is outside groups, which make up 26% of all total spending, compared to 16% at this point in 2012. So this is where the growth is highest. When we look at that by type of money, I'm not sure if you can read the figures, but super PACs just tripped the $1 billion mark. So super PACs, again, what makes them super? They can accept any sum of money from any source as long as it's domestic. And they and outside groups have already spent more than $1.6 billion, $300 million more than in 2012, and that figure will keep climbing today, tomorrow. Although technically super PACs are supposed to disclose their sources, that disclosure doesn't necessarily tell us the original source of the money. Disclosure isn't necessarily the same thing as transparency. Where is this money coming from? The small donor revolution, as some have called it, brought presidential candidate Senator Bernie Sanders a whopping $135 million in an unprecedented 59% coming from individual donors giving small amounts of money, less than $200. But inspiring that kind of a massive, low-dollar following is hard to replicate. This year is probably more aptly dubbed the Year of the Billionaire. You may know the names, or maybe not, but I'll give you a few. Tom Steyer on the left, an environmentalist. Sheldon Adelson on the right, supporter of pro-Israel causes. Donald Sussman, Bob Mercer, and of course the Koch brothers and George Soros, et cetera. In a recent report, we show that just the top 100 families have given about 12% of all money at this point in the cycle, twice as much as they gave in 2012. Ever since the Supreme Court decided Citizens United, which was just discussed, in 2010, and allowed unlimited money from unlimited sources to flow into political campaigns, we've been tracking this money and doing some unique research on these groups working to influence this election. To that end, we've just unveiled our new tool developed in partnership with GuideStar, which is the best-in-class resource tracking nonprofits in the United States. Using their data, we've helped to identify these dark money groups and track some of their political spending, that which we can pull back the curtains on. By March, as this slide shows, it looked as though the dark money spending was heading off the charts. But then, Donald Trump. And this year, then, the secret money has gone further underground. So you see how it drops off. Back in March, we thought it was climbing to a record high, and now it has trailed off. Pledging to spend $899 million through a network of groups that the Koch brothers spearheaded, they did an about-face following the rise of Donald Trump, reducing their commitment to only $250 million and redirecting it away from the presidential ticket to down-ballot races and to less visible activities like their ground operation group, Americans for Prosperity's micro-targeted canvassing operations. But it is not just dismay at Donald Trump's campaign at work here, but a strategy shifting to further ensure secrecy. For the last few years, we've partnered with the prestigious Wesleyan Media Project to analyze political advertising and how many of them are run by non-disclosing nonprofits or dark money groups? The answer, it turns out, is a lot. Dark money groups sponsored 42% of ads by outside groups in competitive Senate races this cycle, up through mid-September. And then there's a steep drop-off to just 11% of those ads. Why the change? Again, it's about disclosure. Many of these groups are hiding not only the donors, but even the mere fact that they're spending money and running ads. As soon as the Federal Election Commission's reporting window opened 60 days before the election, when spending on all broadcast ads that mention candidates had to be divulged to the agency, their ads stopped and the spending was redirected. Before that date, only ads explicitly calling on viewers to vote for or against a candidate had to be reported. And if it matters to the donors and the groups they support that they remain anonymous, you have to wonder, what are they trying to hide? Could it be that exposing who's behind the ads would also expose ulterior motives and undermine their messages? Of course, that's not the only difference with 2012. This race for the White House, as we've discussed, has been far more rancorous, and I would posit present serious challenges given the accusations about rigged elections and foreign hacking, because too many people are already checked out on American democracy, not paying attention, not participating. And this only helps to push more toward the doors. Like you, we care about protecting democratic integrity and accountability, about revitalizing democratic participation and defending transparency. So our message is just the opposite, to encourage people to roll up their sleeves and do the hard work of getting informed, engaging on the issues they care about, demanding access to information they deserve, making themselves heard, and keeping the people we hire to represent us accountable to us. Because, of course, there are plenty of interests who've learned how to work the system, who've invested in armies of lobbyists, and are used to seeing their legislative agenda enacted. They like things just as they are now. They've learned how to work within this system. But the system is not good. Government is dysfunctional. As we've just heard from Commissioner Ravel, there's a good bit of dysfunction even within the agency, which is so important to understanding the amounts and role of money in our elections. There's no stomach for compromise. There's a standoff in Congress. And one member of Congress told me just 2 weeks ago, Congress is broken. And this is a deeply conservative Republican who said this. So imagine what his counterparts in the minority think. I'm going to finish by saying at CRP, we believe our role is simply to gather this data, add value, add context, add meaning, and put it out there and let the chips fall where they may. But if people do not have access to information about all of this money, historic sums, and have faith that it is accurate and comprehensive and reliable and timely, that is going to lend toward an even less sure, more cynical populace, electorate. And so our view is to do our part to put it out there. Again, let the chips fall where they may, let people decide for themselves whether money is a problem, whether there is too much money in politics or too little, but to have faith that they are seeing what they deserve to see about who's funding their elections, and to arm themselves so that they can participate more effectively. Because our view is, if you are not participating, if you're not at the table, you might be on the menu. And we want people to participate not with one hand tied behind their back, but with full access to all of the information they need. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. Before we turn to Jess, I might ask you one question as well. Again, I think many countries in this room will have organizations like yours and civil society trying to do this kind of effort to encourage more transparency in terms of money in politics. So from your long experience, what are some of the challenges that you've faced? You do some investigations on some very sensitive areas. So what are some of the challenges as a civil society oversight sort of organization that you've faced and overcome?
Well, certainly it's so essential to have an agency like the Federal Election Commission providing the data and acting as a resource when we have questions about what we're seeing, why we're seeing something odd or not seeing information. It's fundamental for us to have someone to call to say what's going on with the data. One big challenge we have, because we are number crunchers and we don't have a dog in the fight or a horse in the race, we are simply trying to put the data out there and let it be used by people across the ideological spectrum. One challenge for us is getting our work funded, because we are not promising change. We are simply saying we are the fundamental foundation upon which change will be built. But you can't make change, effective change, if you don't understand what the facts are. So part of the issue is getting foundations, donors, to understand that this is essential no matter what side of the aisle you sit on, no matter what your ideological perspective. And of course, technology, keeping up with the changing pace since our data is so tech-focused.
Great, thank you. So turning to my third panelist, Jess, and I promise, Jess, you're not just the token male on this panel. So Sheila talked a bit about pulling back the curtains on dark money and getting some transparency within the disclosure regime. So Jess, I'm hoping that you will pull back the curtains for us today on the other side, being part of campaign financing. How does it work? What are your thoughts on the current regime that it's in place?
Great, thank you. And thanks to all of you for making the long journey to Washington. I apologize on behalf of my fellow Americans that Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are the two candidates you get to witness tomorrow. There are many of us who wish that was not the case. I will approach this from a different perspective. My job is not to regulate or to comment on the rules that are created by our government when it comes to campaign spending, but to operate within those rules to raise the money and the resources that candidates and good causes need to communicate with voters, make their case, and advocate their cause. And I do that in a couple of different ways. I wear several hats. One is as a fundraiser for organizations and party committees and campaigns. I've raised over my lifetime over $100 million to support causes in which I believe deeply, and in which the individuals and families who wrote checks and made investments believe deeply as well. I've also participated this cycle as what in America we call a bundler. We have very low limits in America for money you can contribute directly to candidates for president or Senate or Congress. And therefore, in order to raise the huge amounts that are necessary to buy television and radio time, newspaper ads, open offices, host large events, candidates must raise very, very large amounts of money in very small increments. So they depend on regular people throughout this country who are willing to not just write their own check for $2,700, but go out to their friends and family and ask them to write checks as well, open up their homes, invite the candidates. And was privileged to do that this year for Marco Rubio, who I will go from here to see tonight in Miami as he faces re-election to the Senate in Florida. I'm also a donor. I'm not wealthy. I'm certainly not a billionaire or a millionaire. But like so many millions of other my fellow Americans, I believe deeply that if you feel passionately about a cause or an idea or a candidate, that you should follow up those beliefs with action, that voting is important, but it's not enough, that we should volunteer, that we should contribute, that we should write checks. When I was very young and had no money, I would write $10 checks to candidates I believed in. As I've grown older and my capacity to give has increased, those checks have become larger, and I can now write checks in thousands. I do not have the capacity to write million-dollar checks, although I would like to think that if I did, I would love my country and the cause enough that I would be so generous and write million-dollar and $10 million checks to candidates I believe in and causes that I believe are important. As Katie said, I've had the privilege to work not just in the United States, but on international democracy projects around the world, from Egypt and Tunisia to Fiji and Myanmar. And I understand the challenges that many of you face in societies and countries that do not have a long and stable history of political freedom and open speech and debate, and the tremendous challenge of raising resources and money needed to communicate a message when you have elections for the first time, when there are state-owned media outlets, or media outlets controlled by a few small corporations and individuals that wield disproportionate power and prevent the voices of the people from being heard. We have some of those same challenges even in the United States. A media that is immensely powerful, that is controlled by a small number of corporations, and that takes the numbers of what we spend on politics and frequently adds multiple zeros in terms of the dollar value that they bring to campaigns and candidates. Katie mentioned the $8 billion that Americans will spend on Halloween this year, a number that is larger than not only the campaign for President of the United States, the most powerful job in the world, but all federal offices combined. And it's an important number to remember. But let's add a few more. There were 21 candidates for president when this campaign started this year. And of those candidates, there was one among the Republicans who was very successful at fundraising, not only for his campaign, but for an outside group, a super PAC that supported his campaign. And that candidate was Jeb Bush. He raised over $100 million before he even declared his candidacy for president. And that money was used in the early primary states during the beginning part of our campaign for president to contrast with and attack his opponents, many of whom had raised a much smaller number. I think that would give my friends and co-panelists some displeasure. A lot of that money came from a small number of individuals. It certainly was frustrating, I will say, as a supporter of one of the other candidates, to have $38 million of that money spent against us in the first four states. But there's a bigger takeaway here than the money that George Bush raised and spent through a super PAC. It is the money and the value of celebrity, or in some cases incumbency, that dwarfs these numbers. When Donald Trump announced his candidacy for president, he was already a household name, having appeared on television week after week and year after year. And the television networks owned by corporations in America gave him, over the course of the primary, $2 billion, with a B, in free advertising and live coverage on television. So we can be concerned, if we want, about the $100 million going to a candidate like Jeb Bush. But that $100 million is a drop in the bucket compared to the value of celebrity, incumbency, and a news media that chooses to cover some candidates with a degree of coverage that dwarfs and overwhelms the others. If you are one of the other 17 candidates as ran as Republicans, you watched in January or February as Donald Trump received 10 to 1, 100 to 1, 500 to 1 more coverage than you do. The only way to level that playing field is to have more money in politics for candidates who want to compete against the celebrities and the incumbents that enjoy this tremendous free media advantage. And the way to do that is to raise the limits, make it easier for people to give large sums of money to the candidates in whom they believe, get more money into the system so there's more competition, more messaging, not just a message from the very powerful, the celebrities, the incumbents, those whose husbands or wives or fathers happen to be presidents of the United States. I'll add one more thought and then turn this over for what I hope is a robust conversation. And that is that it's become popular these days to talk about forced disclosure as if it is always a good thing. And I understand the appeal of knowing where money comes from in politics. I like to know. I go to both of their sites frequently to look at who's giving to whom and how much, and it tells us an important picture. But many of you come from places without a long history of democracy, without constitutional protections for free speech, and this raises, this forced disclosure raises significant questions. We know that in America's early days, when we, our founding fathers, launched this new democracy, that anonymous speech was not only a part of our revolution, it was a central part. That when Thomas Paine wrote Common Sense, a pamphlet that was instrumental in creating American democracy, his name was not anywhere on that pamphlet because of fear of the repercussions, fear of government, fear of citizens who saw things differently. The Federalist Papers, among the most important documents in American political history, were written under the name of Publius for the same reason. And I would argue that we have to find a balance between disclosure and anonymity, and that the starting point for that conversation is a recognition that disclosure is for government, privacy is for citizens. And if we're going to strip away the privacy of citizens to engage in the most fundamental kind of political speech, the kind of speech that our Constitution was written to protect, then we should have a very, very high bar for doing so. For me, I will never fear too much money and too many people involved in politics. My fear will come when there is nobody left to give money and nobody left to knock on doors. I rejoice and I'm happy when I see thousands of people out knocking on doors leading up to Election Day. People who probably don't have a lot of money to give. Maybe there are people who work very hard, they have very little, or they've just retired and they have a small income, so they cannot write a large check of $1,000 or $100,000 or $1 million. But they have time, and they will go out and talk to their friends and their neighbors and knock on doors and campaign passionately for the candidate in whom they believe. But maybe their neighbor is busy building a company that employs thousands of people. That person is equally passionate about the candidate he believes, but there is no way he can go every morning to the campaign headquarters and knock on doors and put up signs. So instead, he writes a check, as large a check as he can afford to support this big idea, this candidate that he loves. I want more of this, more knocking on doors, more voting, more contributors, more money, because that is what gives us the robust competition that democracy deserves.
Thank you, Jess. We've had a few mentions of the media from our panelists, so I wish we had a representative from the media as well to give that perspective, but perhaps that's something we can come back to. Before we turn over to questions, maybe just a question that was prompted by some of your comments, Jess. And one thing I've always admired about you is the enthusiasm that you bring to everything that you do, your belief in democracy, both here in the US and internationally. But my question is really around ideology versus influence, and your point about people giving funds for something they believe in and the ideology. So what about those folks who perhaps give for influence? I know you give for ideology, but how can I be sure that the 90 billionaires contributing to the super PACs are giving for the same motivations as opposed to influence, either on the outcome or on decisions of those elected after the election?
That's a great question. Sheila and I were talking before the panel began about the difference of fundraising in Washington, D.C. in fundraising in the rest of this country. This is a city where people hire lobbyists and give money for just that reason. They want influence. They want to influence policy outcomes, rulemaking. In the rest of the country, where I've been privileged to work, I have met tens of thousands of donors over the years, almost all of whom are motivated by a belief in a political philosophy. On the left, a desire to have a social safety net that protects the least among us. On the right, a passionate belief in opportunity to succeed or fail on your merits, to live your life without government interference. And the major donors who make up the huge, this large block of individuals who give to super PACs are overwhelmingly in the philosophically and ideologically minded camp. Not just on the right, where I work, but on the left as well. Charles and David Koch are passionate believers in free markets. One ran for vice president as a libertarian, not a very practical thing to do if you want power in the United States, but a deep belief in principle. The same is true of George Soros. He is a liberal, we don't agree. I'm glad that he gives generously. So from my experience, the huge, overwhelming majority of Americans who participate financially in politics are giving based on a motivation that is altruistic and that most of us would honor and respect, even if we don't agree that they should be allowed to give such large amounts or give them anonymously.
Great, thank you. So we have around 30 minutes for questions and discussion. I'm hoping there will be lots of questions in the room. So again, if you can just raise your hand. We've got folks with microphones who can come around. Michael, over here. Yep, please. And please, yeah, let us know your name and organization.
I'm Sumro from Pakistan. With every election, there is always a galore of surveys. Every kind of surveys are there. So my question is, are these surveys inspired or motivated by candidates directly or indirectly? Has there been any research carried out to establish any correlation?
Great, thank you. I'll collect a few questions first and then turn to the panelists. Yes, in the middle here.
Thank you. I am Senator Ovie Omoagege, National Assembly, Nigeria. My question is directed to Commissioner Ravel. Listening to you, I'm just curious. The Federal Election Commission, where you are commissioner, my understanding is all elections in America are state elections. There are no federal elections. Now, you're a commissioner in Federal Electoral Commission, which obviously is a federal body, considering that you are appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. Now, my question is, beyond regulation of campaign financing, is there any other functions that your commission is supposed to carry out? That's a question for you. Then let me just add for Jess. Where I come from in Nigeria, I personally, as a legislator, I believe there's too much money in the system. We're looking for ways to regulate campaign financing of our elections. But of course, listening to you, you actually want more money, you know. And you've actually given the reasons why you believe there should be more money in the system. I've also been an observer of the American electoral system. I know the role played by the likes of the Koch family in unregulated campaign funding, and also the activities of bodies like the NRA, how they unleash funding, you know, against people who they perceive to be against the Second Amendment rights. So I'm wondering, why do you think more money is needed? You want more money to unleash against people who take positions contrary to those advocated by those who have this money? Thank you very much.
Great, we'll take one more. I think Commissioner Sharma down here. Thank you.
This is Ila Sharma from Nepal. My question is for Jess on the similar lines. It really worries me when you talk about more money, because in Nepal, for emerging democracies, this is going to become a huge divide. You know, there will be some people who will be able to contest elections all the time, and women, other underprivileged communities will never be able to contest elections. And they will be used only as vote banks, exploited. And I do not understand why in a country like USA, which is an institutionalized democracy, an old democracy, you are still talking about money, where people should have developed a culture of going to vote as part of their citizens' duty, and money should have nothing to do with it.
Great, thank you. So I'll turn to a panelist. So we've got the question from Pakistan regarding surveys, public surveys and polling. Are they inspired by candidates? Is there a correlation? And then from Nigeria, a little bit about the mandate of the FEC as a federal body. And again, whether there's too much money. This will go to Jess. And then from Nepal, in the sense of with so much money in the system, can women, can minorities, can other groups actually contest? So Commissioner, would you like to start?
With regard to the FEC, our mandate is to oversee money, both expenditures and contributions to federal campaigns, that is the presidency, the Congress, so Senate and House of Representatives candidates. That's our mandate. We don't oversee actual elections, but we also have responsibility for the national, federal, presidential campaign, public campaign finance system, which hasn't been used by very many people since President Obama didn't take the money in 2008. And we also have some oversight over the conventions and some other things, like foreign money coming into the country and that is into political campaigns, and that's whether it is federal or local, we have that responsibility. But essentially, you're correct, the conduct of elections themselves is done throughout the country statewide.
And Jess, some of the tricky questions for you.
I appreciate those questions. Beginning with polling, the easier of the three. There are two reasons, primarily, that polling is done with great frequency in the United States. By media outlets, it drives ratings because citizens who are interested in the horse race, knowing the contest and the numbers, like to tune in and hear who's winning. Campaigns use polling to better understand the electorate, to know not just what citizens believe, but why they believe it. And if there are three different issues we could talk about, which of those three is going to be of the biggest concern to voters? And it helps us shape our message. Sometimes polling can be used to deliver a message rather than gain information. We call this push-pulling in the US, and it is discouraged and frowned upon by most political professionals and the media. And it is much less common in this election cycle than it has in the past. To my friends from Nigeria and Nepal, I would pose a question to you. In your countries, does the media cover politics? Does the newspaper write articles? Do television news stations cover the race? Those institutions are owned by corporations or individuals, or in some cases by government. And if candidates do not have the money to get their own message out, the only news voters will get is from those institutions, from newspapers and TV. In my country this year, $2 billion of free advertising to Donald Trump is a very large reason that he is the Republican nominee. If you take away the money from the competitors, the other 16, to raise for them to even just get a piece of mail out to voters, or an ad on the in the radio or on television, we make it even more difficult for those constituencies, ma'am, that you spoke about, the underprivileged, for their voice to be heard, because the corporate interests, the powerful interests that control the media, will be the only voices. I don't think that is good for democracy. Therefore, I want more people, more money, more activity, so that there can be a robust debate and all voices can be heard.
Thank you. Thank you. I want the opportunity to weigh in on this issue too, because I think, ma'am, that you asked a very important question that has a huge impact in the United States as well. And that is that money, what you said was, if you're not at the table, you're going to be eaten. Money is the way to get to the table to begin with. And that is the problem in the United States for both minority and women candidates, or people of lower economic strata. And so the fact that most of the money, and I said this, it's something like 98% of the super PAC money comes from white men. What that means is women, minorities, can't even run. So it cuts them off as even being viable candidates. And as a result, in this country, we have only 20% of women in the Senate, 18% in the House of Representatives. We have very few women governors and women in state legislatures. And the same is true of minorities. And the reason for that is just what you said, that it is so expensive to run for office that there is no access to funding for those people, because they don't have those wealthy people who are giving money to them to be able to run, which is one reason why, and I know you may want to discuss this more, but why some of the small donor matches and other public funding is such an important part of having a more fair electoral process.
Add one point, small point, and that is, in my own personal opinion, not speaking as an expert on politics here, but personally I think that there was no amount of money for the Republican opponents of Donald Trump that would have mattered, that would have made a difference. It was his celebrity, absolutely. $2 billion in earned media is a key piece of it, but it is because he is a walking, talking news story, and therefore it wouldn't have mattered having more donors, more millions given to his opponents. They could not contest what he was offering, which was something radically different, and that was what drew people to his campaign. So maybe more money would have mattered, in my own personal opinion. Once you reach a threshold amount, it is no longer about the money, but about the qualities of the candidate, their message, their organization, and whether they offer something new and exciting or something more traditional.
Thank you. Just before we move to another round of questions, the commissioner raised the issue of public funding. making the point that since 2008, it's not something that's really been utilized, certainly in the presidential race in the US. And some have called, I think, the funding in presidential campaigns a real arms race. And I think, Jess, your point is more money is needed for candidates simply to compete with the media, the messages coming from the media. So has have elections, have campaigns in the US just become too expensive that both sides cannot unilaterally disarm? So what are your thoughts about the arms race of campaign funding?
Well, a couple of points. First is, this arms race has relative parity. This is not a question of one side dramatically outraising the other side and winning an election by default because they have all of the money. In American politics, and this is true in many parts of the world, large donors split fairly evenly between the conservative and the liberal party, and both sides are well-funded. So you have mega donors on the left, like Soros, and on the right, like the Kochs, who are willing to step up and write big checks, as well as millions of others writing very small checks. That parity, I think, is an important part of this conversation, because that the money that they provide to each side is what allows for what we all like to think of as campaign activity to take place. When you get a phone call from a volunteer, they're sitting in a campaign office on a telephone that was paid for with donors' money, or perhaps they're utilizing technology and calling from home on their computer. When in Ohio a couple of nights ago, 12,000 Democrats showed up to hear Jay-Z and Beyonce cheer on Hillary Clinton, the $4 or $5 million that it costs to produce those kinds of concerts around the country for Hillary Clinton were paid for with donors' money. The mail that you get, the ads on TV, the thousands of staff people who are organizing. You cannot on one hand say, we love citizen participation in politics, but on the other hand, we don't want any money because it is the money that makes all of that possible. As far as public funding, I would simply suggest that of all of the needs of the people of the United States and the people of the world, all of the things that hardworking citizens are already taxed for, with tax money already spent, you know, trillions of dollars, that paying for the campaigns of politicians should be very low on the list of priorities when there are children to be educated and diseases to fight and businesses to grow.
I can see the commissioner is itching to respond, please.
Yes, the federal presidential public funding was never and has never been funded through taxpayer money. It is voluntary checkoffs on people's tax returns, but it's totally voluntary. And we have a lot of money still sitting there. The problem is that because there was a potential of so much money being spent on the other side, that President Obama decided not to take the public funding. Up until then, everyone, every major presidential candidate in this country took federal funding. So if the amount of money is increased so that the word can get out, and I don't disagree with you on that subject. I mean, I think that it's very important for people to have the ability to engage the public, assuming that's what they actually do with their money, which I think, you know, we could talk about micro-targeting and how they're not really trying to engage anybody but the people that they are getting the money from and their people they know are gonna vote for them. But nonetheless, going with that premise, I mean, I do think that it's important to have money. I don't disagree with that. I just think that part of what has happened with this arms race of money is that everyone from president all the way down to state offices have to spend all their time currying favor with the wealthy in order to get enough money to be able to run, instead of actually thinking about representing the people and listening to the issues that the people bring before them. And that's why public funding in at least some circumstances is probably the best solution.
Okay, some more questions. If we could collect four questions, I think, starting here.
Thank you. My name is Salome Oyugi from the Independent Electoral Commission of Kenya. My first three questions go to Anne and Sheila. When you read the Citizens United case, yes, what the court did, they actually gave a green light to the organizations to spend unlimited amounts. But in so doing, they did not restrict the ban on contributions. And the court tried to create a distinction between the influence in expenditures and the influence in contributions by an understanding that expenditures are not directly related to coordination of campaigns. Yet from both your presentations, we are aware that through contributions, you find ways of circumventing the system, and we have persons contributing large amounts of monies to these organizations. From your platform, what mechanisms moving forward are you putting in place to curtail this kind of circumvention? And even as we talk of contributions, what approach do you use in setting limits? Do you take the approach of the amount that a single source can contribute to a candidate or political party, or you take the candidate approach or political approach where we say this candidate or this political party cannot receive this much in entirety? Issues of transparency, you've talked about disclosure mechanisms, and I wish to know, does disclosure extend directly to these organizations? And as you request them to disclose, is this by way of publication of accounts? Do they present their financial accounts to you? Do you as FEC see yourself undertaking, or do you actually undertake an extra role of investigation? And lastly, to Jess, my question to you is in a different perspective. As a sponsor of this, through as a sponsoring organization, I'm looking at it in the context of corporate democracy. In your shoes, how would you deal with a situation whereby your shareholders within your corporate organization do not support the cause through which you're expending this particular money? Thank you.
Great. Take three more. Sir at the back.
Thank you. My name is Latif Raji from the Lagos State Independent Electoral Commission. I read somewhere this morning that probably the 2016 election in the United States is going to be the most expensive. But I also see here that in 2020, the election will be more expensive than that of 2016. But because at every electoral circus, the money will be, the stake will be getting higher and higher. And that is the reason why I want to ask, can't we develop a template that will, you know, a universal template that will accommodate electoral expenditures, and also, you know, taking into consideration the peculiarity of all the countries, and also correct the lopsided or unrealistic legal framework in many developing democracies that, you know, tend to support peg donations, where, you know, the amount one can donate into a campaign. At the end of the day, in most of these developing, you know, democracies, you just find out that those things are not actually what they are. Nobody measures them. Nobody knows how much is, you know, taken from individuals. It's okay to talk about the United States, but so many other developing democracies does not have those framework that actually tells anybody this is the amount a political party receives in an election. In the last presidential election in my country, in one fell swoop, 21 billion naira was raised. Up till now, we keep asking questions. How did we come about this? Nobody has been able to tell us this is who donated what. So it's going to be a very good idea if we could now sit down here and look at a universal template that will accommodate electoral expenditure. Thank you very much.
Great, and I've got one question over here.
Thank you very much. My name is Senator Abdullahi Gumel. I come from Nigeria National Assembly. You have to be patient with us because Nigeria is the only nation that has similarity in governance like the United States. We have a presidential system of government. From what you are saying on the finances, especially the male speaker, what you are saying, you need more money in the system. We are looking at the other side that we need probity. We need quality of the leaders that will come whether they have money or they don't. But we come here to learn, but we shouldn't go back to our various countries thinking that we can only conduct an election if we have money. Whether the candidates have quality or not, if they have money, that means we can probe up junks in our system. But I think we have to have a yardstick, a template, like the other speaker has said, that the government or the public finances has to come in to regulate how much a candidate can spend. But if you leave it open-ended, I think in the third world, I think we are heading to something else, not a good electoral system. Thank you.
Great, thank you. We'll stop there just because we're starting to run out of time, and I'll turn over to the panelists. There's a lot to answer there. Influence and expenditures and donations, limits whether to candidates or political parties, disclosure, how do they do disclosure in this country? And then for Jess, corporate democracy, what happens when you're in a corporation and shareholders don't support? The idea of developing a template, or does an ideal campaign finance system actually exist? And how do we get quality in our leadership, you know, whether there's money or not? Who would like to go first? And again, we don't have a lot of time, so short and sweet answers.
Sure. beginning with the last question first, I would argue that the best way to allow people who are not already rich and powerful and famous to have a chance to win elections is to give them the opportunity to raise money from others so that they have a platform for their own voice. Donald Trump did not need to raise any money to have his voice heard this year. Hillary Clinton, the wife of a president, did not need to raise any money to have her voice heard. Senator Rubio from Florida is the son of a hotel bartender and a maid who came here as immigrants, lives in the same neighborhood where he was born, has no money of his own. If you take away the opportunity for guys like Marco to raise money, they will have no way to compete. The same is true of Bernie Sanders, who raised hundreds of millions of dollars with an average contribution of just 28. These are inspiring stories of people with modest personal wealth being able to go out and raise money to have a platform and have their voice be heard. On the question of corporate democracy, I would ask you to take a look at the funding for super PACs in this country, which is the subject that has come up most on this panel. That's where the very large checks come from. you will find on average less than 5% of the dollars coming to super PACs are from corporations. There's no shareholder issue because most companies are not writing checks. And if they do, they're very small. They buy a table at a dinner. They tend to not write $1 million, $10 million checks. Those are coming from individuals and families giving their own personal money because they are passionate supporters of a candidate or a cause. And that is true of both Democrats and Republicans. So I'll leave it there.
Great. Commissioner?
Well, I agree with respect to corporate contributions to super PACs for the most part, because there are generally greater mechanisms for determining who's giving the money. And a number of corporations have had some issues with giving money, and it comes to light both to their shareholders and to the American public, and people then try to not support the functions of those corporations. For example, a well-known one was Target, that where there was money given to a particular candidate who opposed gay rights, and that created a large problem once people found out. So I do agree that a lot of the money that we know about comes from individuals. However, corporations do have many other mechanisms for funneling the money so that it is not public. One of them is to IRS groups. But I know you have a million other questions, and I'll stop.
I'll just put you in one comment, and I apologize. I'm not sure I fully followed all of the questions. But the thing that I wanted to add was that super PACs and nonprofits, the issue there for us, because we don't advocate for limits on campaign contributions or for public financing, we simply advocate for, the only thing we advocate for is transparency and enforcing the law. If you're going to pass the law, it should be enforced. But the issue, I just want to emphasize the issue with super PACs, which do disclose their donations. The information that they disclose is not always helpful to conveying where the money is actually coming from. And furthermore, again, that very often these organizations are not independent enough from the campaigns, that they are run by the former campaign strategists, chiefs of staff, top lieutenants of the campaigns, of the candidates, and maybe after a short break, just transfer from the campaign to the independent super PAC, which is dedicated exclusively to promoting their former boss. And so I think from my perspective, the Citizens United decision was based on faulty logic, thinking that we have disclosure when we do not in all cases, and thinking that these organizations would be independent, but not providing a way to guarantee that is in fact true.
Just to follow up quickly on this point, one of the very strange results of Citizens United and the hodgepodge of campaign finance rules in America is that if two candidates are running for office, you may contribute only $2,700 to those candidates directly for messages that they control for their own campaign, but you can give $27 million to an outside group that supports those candidates. And obviously what happens is the candidates lose control of their own message. The candidates will now spend much less money through their own campaigns than the outside groups will spend. And I think the remedy for this problem is to either raise or abolish the limits on what citizens can give directly to campaigns, so that if you want to give $10,000, give it to the candidate you support, not the outside super PAC supporting this candidate from a distance. that it helps with both transparency and with accountability.
I'm going to come back. I think we could keep going on this a long time. We have about a minute, and I would really like to sort of give a last word to each of our three panelists, particularly thinking about the audience that we have here, 80 different countries, different commissions. What is something that you would like to leave with the participants in this room on this difficult topic?
Thank you. That's actually the question I wanted to address, and it was whether or not there could be a template. And actually, I believe that all of us can learn a lot from one another by our own experiences and what goes on in each country. I know I've spent a lot of time going to Latin America, and I'm very impressed by some of the ways that they address campaign finance issues. So it seems to me there really, though, can't be a template, because the campaign finance system has to represent the culture. It has to be something that works for each country.
Thank you. Sheila?
I guess I would just follow up on Jess's last comment to say that on the one hand, it is obviously preferable for people to be able to give more to the candidates in order to be able to compete with the huge sums of money flowing to these less accountable outside groups, but for the fact that only less than 0.5% of US, of Americans, currently give contributions even of $200. So to give a contribution even of $200 is really unthinkable, if not out of reach, for the vast majority of Americans. And if we say, well, it's only a $6 billion, $7 billion election, really we need more money, let's make it a $10 billion election, why not $20 billion? We spend more on going out to eat or chewing gum, and what's more important, democracy or chewing gum? So we need to invest more. That's fine, except that what that means is it ratchets up the amount of money that is spent on elections, meaning that candidates need more money to compete, meaning that fewer and fewer Americans can hope, dream of participating in electoral politics, and fewer Americans can hope that their small contribution, if they can afford to make one, matters.
And Jess.
First of all, thank you all for what you do in your countries. The world is a better and safer and freer place when we embrace democracy, and the role that you play is absolutely critical to strengthening and growing democracy and free and fair elections around the world. So all of us say thank you. I would argue that I would hope you would go home with a renewed commitment to as much speech as possible in your countries, to as much freedom as possible in the campaign process, and to creating a system in which even poor candidates have the ability to go out and raise money from others so that their voice, too, can be heard. Thank you.
Thank you. So we're moving into an afternoon break, again, just in the foyer outside. Just a couple of comments. The issue of gender came up a lot in this panel, and my colleague Jessica will be moderating a panel on gender tomorrow morning. We're reconvening here at 4. My colleague Erica will be moderating a panel on cybersecurity in elections. So please join me in thanking my panelists one more time for a fascinating discussion.